There has been a good development. The final year project, the BTEC and chemical engineering students are doing together. Chemical engineers will understand how the processes are developed, and BTEC students will understand how to scale up, how to design equipment on commercial basis. What is not taught in great detail in the classroom is the theory of mixing and what are the current practices. And that is going to be the main theme of this lecture series. We know there are many types of industries. Refineries, you know, petrochemicals, fertilizers, and then specialty industries. And our 7 branches of technology are designed to cater the needs of specialty industry. We have dyes and textiles and food and oils and polymers and pharma and paints, and that is surface coatings. So let there be any type of industry, either this, in addition to this one important technology branch we are missing is agrochemicals. Then catalyst manufacture. Surface active agents get included in oils and surfactants. So these are types of industries. Let there be any turnover. In India, the turnover of refinery industry is the highest. That of Reliance Refinery and Indian Oil Corporation is of the order of 4 lakh crores. Next comes the petrochemicals, which is in the range of 50,000 to 100,000 crores. Fertilizers are about 25,000 crores. The specialty industry, the biggest one in India now, is 40,000 crores. The smallest one can be anything, right from 1 crore. So what I'm trying to bring to your attention is, let there be any type of industry, any scale of industry, any turnover, let it be very small or medium or large scale industry, the mixing equipment is definitely common. The lowest turnover industry, you can say, is kitchen, where we do a lot of chemical reactions. Gelatinization reaction is cooking of gas and lentils, and many other reactions we carry out. And definitely in kitchen you see a mixer. Correct. So right from mixer in the household, the largest stirred tank reactor that I have designed in India for Reliance is 1 million liters. So a household mixer of 1 liter, suppose we carry out the same reaction, it is the monomer of polyester, terephthalic acid. And terephthalic acid, how to do the experiments in 1 liter mixing equipment in the laboratory? What experiment should be performed in order to get confidence? What kind of data should be collected? How to process the data? And what are the rules of scale up? That is going to be the content of this lecture series. My advice is, let chemical engineers also do the experiments and technology students also take participation in the actual process design. And then it will be really wonderful, exceptional experience. I don't think this type of experience will be available anywhere, any university in the world. And since I'm practicing mixing, this is my 46th year, so I will be very happy to impart all my experience to you. Entire experience, I'll tell you. I'm the most wanted consultant in India. Most busy. Have designed thousands of reactors and many other equipment. I'm telling this to you not to tell you that how great I am, but you take benefit of all this in terms of your doubts. If you don't understand, you can always ask me. You can write your questions, and anyway, at the end of the lecture, during the lecture, anytime you can ask me, but take the benefit. Another important statement I'm going to make: whenever I speak on public platform, and let it be industrialists in front of me, I make a statement: I can increase your profit by 30%. And actually I do more. I can increase the profit of your industry by 30%. The only requirement is that I should not have seen your industry. When I see, I will come to know what are the knowledge gaps. And when those knowledge gaps are filled in a current operating industry with minor changes, minor modifications in the equipment, we can increase the turnover by 30 to 50%, sometimes 100%, and increase the profitability. You take benefit of all this. What is the source of this confidence? And out of the large number of equipment which are employed in chemical industry, the most common, I have already told you, are the most common equipment which I need to change in order to enhance the profit by 30% is again stirred tank reactor. All right. Coincidentally, we do not learn that equipment in so much great detail and that you are working together. So this coincidence, we will use it for mastering the technology of mixing, the data collection, and the scale-up. Why this equipment is so commonly employed? Is it efficient? Is it inexpensive as compared to others? What is so great about it?
Design is simple.
Design is simple, yeah. There are even simpler designs which I can share with you. There are definitely simpler designs. Whatever stirred tank can do, a pipeline can do. Yeah. See, whenever there is a chemical reaction, let it be sulfonation or esterification or polymerization, we need a certain level of conversion. And for any reaction, there is a kinetics. And kinetics gives the rate of chemical reaction with respect to concentration. Obviously, the rate decreases with decrease in concentration, and when we get 99% conversion or 99.9% conversion, and when it is reaction controlled, then the time required for desired level of conversion is same in ICT, same in IIT, same in Berlin, same in Japan, same in pipeline, same in stirred tank reactor, right? Because anyway it is reaction controlled. When mass transfer participates along with chemical reaction, and then we need to understand the combined effect of the mass transfer with chemical reaction. The mass transfer can be different from equipment to equipment. The methodology to combine mass transfer with chemical reaction is the same, but your statement can be taken positively that we should analyze mass transfer in pipeline and mass transfer in stirred tank reactor and whether the stirred tank reactors are attractive. Any other reason you feel? One was simple in construction, and another was simple in operation, and perhaps it is efficient also, right? These were the reasons given.
Controlling some reaction, it's better to have CST reactor in pipeline, because the temperature control is not efficient in pipeline reactor compared to CST.
Right. The recent advances in practice indicate that convert all stirred tank reactors to pipeline reactors, and these pipeline reactors are capillaries and called micro reactors. You might have heard this word, but basically these are pipeline reactors. If you take stirred tank reactor, the surface area is pi d L, correct? No? Pi d is perimeter multiplied by length is pi d L, plus of course some area of the bottom dish is available, but let us take pi d L, and the volume is pi by 4 d square L. So area to volume ratio is how much? Calculate pi d L upon pi by 4 d square L, 4 upon d, right. So if diameter is say 1 meter, then what is the area? 4 meter square per meter cube, correct? If you take pipeline reactor, equation is the same, but now you take a capillary of say 100 microns, that is 100 into 10 raised to minus 6, and 6 upon 100 into 10 raised to minus 6, how much is that? 4000. So instead of 4 meter square per meter cube, now you get area of 4000 meter square per meter cube. And temperature control is eminently possible, right? And there is substantial enhancement in mass transfer as well in micro reactors, but still 90%, more than 90% stirred tank reactors are used. The major reason is reliability. These equipment don't deceive us. They are not cheap, they are expensive, there are rotating parts, so maintenance is required. It is not straightforward, it is headache. But if you want to carry out reaction up to 99% conversion, 99.9% conversion, it happens. In a pipeline reactor, those reactors, they need a lot of expertise before the design, whereas stirred tank reactors many times are offered by fabricators directly, right? So these are the reliable equipment, and therefore reliability is the only and principal reason. As far as efficiency is concerned, cost is concerned, heat transfer is concerned, mass transfer is concerned, dispersion is concerned, suspension is concerned, power consumption is concerned, in all the cases it is inferior, right? Whatever statements I make, you have an authority to get explanation right now, because no statement should be a loose statement, and you should ask for explanation either during the lecture, end of the lecture, or at any time. Now what I said, instead of stirred tank reactor, you take a bunch of capillaries put together and 4 meter square goes to 4000 meter square, correct? If you take gas liquid dispersion, then in a pipeline bubbles are followed by liquid, followed by bubble, but now bubbles are of the size of 50 microns or 100 microns, and the interfacial area that we get is again the fraction of gas divided by size of the bubble, and fraction of the gas can be 20%, 30%, so 0.3 divided by 0.405 is huge interfacial area and huge mass transfer coefficient. But if current chemical engineers are asked design a micro reactor, then the difficulty starts. Design stirred tank reactor, anybody is able to design, right? But the way in which I'm going to teach you, that will not be anybody, it will be experts design. So I'm going to teach you how to perform experiments in the laboratory, get the right information. What are the scale-up experiments that we should be doing for understanding the hydrodynamics as well as mass transfer and sometimes heat transfer, and scale it up to any scale, 10 meter cube, 50 meter cube, 100 meter cube, and I mentioned to you 1000 meter cube. So that will be the subject. Stirred tank, though anybody can design and it can be reliable, see, if you take a glass of milk and put sugar inside and you want to homogenize sugar, you put anything inside and it can mix, no? You can put spoon inside, you can put rod inside, and rods can be of any size, eventually it will be mixed, right? In the case of spoon, it will take 10 seconds. In some other case, it will take maybe few minutes. And if you don't insert anything, yesterday I taught in the class and it indicates that it will take 59 days to mix, but it will mix. It will do the job. So as far as doing the job, the reliability is concerned, it is. So this reliability, people are comfortable, and therefore, so that is the explanation why these equipment are very, very popular. I'm not going to teach you any other equipment other than stirred tank reactor. I told you the reason, more than 90-95% still the reactors are stirred tank. When these are operated continuously, we call it as CSTR, but in majority of cases, as far as specialties industry is concerned, with which all of you are intimately related, these are operated in batch mode. Let us see the examples of practical importance. I'm going to circulate a list of examples of industrial importance, all right? These stirred tank reactors are used where liquid is alone. There can be liquid-liquid dispersions. Immiscible liquid is dispersed in another liquid. There can be gas-liquid dispersions. There can be solid-liquid dispersions. There can be gas-liquid-solid dispersions. There can be gas-liquid-liquid dispersions. Gas-liquid-liquid-solid dispersions, all right? So for all these multiphase cases, stirred tank reactors are used. What I'm going to do is circulate by email the examples of industrial importance under each category, the liquid alone, the liquid-liquid, gas-liquid, solid-liquid, gas-liquid-solid, and maybe under each category 30-35 examples, right. So, you will get an idea, but before you read those examples, since you have learnt a lot of chemistry in your undergraduate, let us list some of the applications which we need to implement. Let us start with dyestuff technology. What is that you do? You do sulfonation? If you do, then only you say yes. Do you do a sulfonation? Are dye students, are they there?
Yes.
Do you do sulfonation?
Yes.
Nitration? Esterification? Acylation? Let us write down some of them. Definitely you do diazotization. Reduction is very important, and reductions are done by variety of means, and one of them is hydrogenation for reduction. So, I am writing hydrogenation, but we can write some other. One more, dye students, do you carry out hydrolysis, esterification, ammonolysis, acylation, chlorination, bromination, hydrochlorination, any one reaction? Okay, four, maybe in some other technology. Now, next is fiber and textile processing. What is that you do? You need a large number of processing chemicals, and you need a lot of surface active agents, right? Use a lot of ethoxylation, ethylene oxide reactions. For surface treatment, you do hydrolysis. Now you tell me, textile people, any other reaction that you carry out?
Bleaching,
yeah. Bleaching. Textile people try to get one more example. Let me go to food. What do you do? Esterification. But I will not write it for you because I have already. You will have to tell me something different now. The simplest for food is cooking, no? Is cooking.
Fermentation.
Very good. Very good. Fermentation. Then
pasteurization,
yeah. Pasteurization, very good. Tell me one more.
Enzymatic browning.
Enzymatic browning, yeah. I'll write only Browning. But there are many more, no? There are many more. Food people. How many food products are there? Imagine few food products and try to see. Anyway, four examples are there. From food, let us go the oils and surfactants. Epoxidation. Have you written esterification? Esterification. Where do you do esterification? Saponification. Or do you want to write? Have you written hydrolysis up till now?
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah, but that is very important, fat splitting.
Combustion.
Combustion. Means for cooking you need combustion? Oh, yeah, okay. So that is the source of energy. That is the source of energy. Very good. Tell me one more. Transesterification. Bad diesel, yeah. So you release glycerin and attach methanol, transesterification. Pharma people.
Chlorination.
Do you do also bromination? So let me write halogenation. Okay. Do you do Friedelcraft? Have I written alkylation already? Alkylation, you do acylation also? All right. Condensations, are you very good? Alkylation, acylation, oxidation. And while doing oxidation, like reduction, there are so many possibilities, so many oxidizing agents. Earlier years, we used to use potassium dichromate, sodium permanganate. Right from there, we have come up to hydrogen peroxide and ozone. Oxidation is possible with oxygen in air. Ozonolysis is possible. So in oxidation itself, there is a huge variety in oxidation. Polymers, of course, polymerization. But you must do three more things other than polymerization. Polymers and surface coatings, we can put them together. Are polymerization people, tell me.
Sir, vulcanization
of rubber, yeah. All right. Sulfur? Yeah. I understand that. Curing. curing means completion of polymerization up to end, are you meaning that?
Cross-linking.
Cross-linking. Let us write cross-linking. Yeah. You have so many polymers and so many polymers in surface coatings. Before polymerization, you have so many monomers, no? And those monomers are made by a variety of reactions. So tell me those reactions. What is, say, PVC? What is the monomer? Vinyl chloride. How vinyl chloride is made? Chlorination. However, we have written chlorination already. Okay. Then go to polyethylene. What is the monomer? How do we get ethylene? Got it? Yeah. So this way you go backwards. Now polyester. What do you need for polyester? Ethylene glycol. How do you get ethylene glycol? Reaction of ethylene oxide with water. That is called? Hydrolysis. Have we written hydrolysis already? Okay. So that is done. For making ethylene oxide, what do we do? We convert ethylene into ethylene oxide. It is simple oxidation. It is oxidation. If you use epoxide for the reaction, then it is called epoxidation. When only oxygen is introduced into the ethylene, it is oxidation. Tell me one more. Just one more. Any other polymer? Condensation. Are so nice. Very good. Actually, within polymerization, there are large number. But let me write condensation. All of you are in the final year, and after third year, you have gone to practice your respective industries. Have you observed stirred tank reactors at least from outside?
Yes.
Everybody, who has not seen stirred tank reactor, raise your hand. So let us see which industry you. Was it polymer processing industry? So there are about 10% students who have not seen this stirred tank reactor. But you have seen mixer in household.
Yes.
Correct, no? So generally, how it looks like, you know. Now, we have seen large number of examples here. And I can tell you some more examples in fertilizer industry, in petrochemical industry, in the refinery industry. But the point remains the same. We come from different branches. Some chemical engineers are sitting here. Let it be agrochemicals. For executing these reactions, in 90% of the cases, we again use stirred tank reactor. So if we understand and learn the theory and practice of stirred tank reactor, the branch is immaterial. The branch is immaterial. So that is what I wanted to emphasize. Let it be any turnover, any type of industry, and any size of industry. These stirred tank reactors are very common. And I can tell you, if it is designed and optimized properly, then how much reduction is possible in capital cost as well as in operating cost, right? In order to make it economical. A little digression. Our chemical industry as such entirely is doing worldwide only 1% business. What is the reason? We are not economical. When we are economical, everybody looks at the quality and the price. We are not economical. The principal reason is our capital costs are high. For putting any chemical industry, we need to spend lot of money. Why do we need to spend lot of money? Because most of the technologies we buy from outside. Please listen to me next 3, 4, 5 sentences. If you don't bring technology from inside and design optimally our equipment, not any design which can perform, we can be 3 times, 5 times, 10 times cheaper. Very recently, my students made bulletproof jacket. And they used for some of the activities, definitely they used a tank reactor. The bulletproof jacket, after testing by all defense establishments who can certify the bulletproof jacket, now we are going to manufacture 1 lakh jackets per year in India. The cost of the jacket made by the students, our own students of ICT, is 30,000 rupees per jacket. Up till now it was imported and it was 3 lakh rupees. So 3 lakh rupees has been brought down to 30,000, and students have confidence that they will do further research and bring it down to 15,000 rupees. The point I am arriving at is, let us try to understand the science and practice of commercial designs so that the products become very attractive. And when we don't make it, we are unable to sell it, and we are buying technologies from outside, then we are dependent, no? We discuss so much about those French aeroplanes. What is the name? Right. And there are headlines also, so many times. But in my view, I have not seen any person worrying about, are we are unable to make it. And the discussion is on totally different subject altogether. See how much dependent we are. Large number of defense equipment. Israel, for example, they are selling us defense equipment worth 80,000 crores. And they are selling us, let it be any sector of utilization, they are selling us. Let it be agriculture, let it be solar energy, let it be anything, they are selling us. So how do they earn money? How the Israeli people earn money? They work hard, they innovate in such a way that the price is very attractive as compared to anywhere in the world, and they sell. And Israel Prime Minister visited India and made an agreement of selling something, quite a few things, 70,000 crores. And you must have read, Canadian Prime Minister came, and Mr. Putin came 2 times, and Australian Prime Minister came, Chinese Prime Minister came, from South Africa also that Prime Minister came, and everybody did some. And we are buying everything from outside. We are not making and exporting. We are doing business 1%, just 1%. And we are the best in chemical industry, because in electronics we make zero, therefore chemical industry is much better, which is 1%. My message to my dear young friends, let anybody do anything in the world, we are capable of making. I am making this statement with total convincing. The bulletproof jacket which was made, imported jacket, is 13 kilograms in weight, and this is 6.5 kilograms in weight, right? And 15,000 rupees. It is going to save 3,000 crores for the nation. And I can give you large number of examples which have been developed in our laboratory, in ICT, and saving thousands and thousands of crores for the nation and making processes attractive. So out of all those possible technologies, can we learn the theory and practice of mixing equipment at least, right? And that will be the subject of our discussion. So with this background, that we shall make for our own industry under consideration, let it be acylation, alkylation, hydrolysis, condensation, the equipment that I shall design will be the cheapest in the world, right? So that much science and practice behind mixing equipment, design of mixing equipment, we should learn. And it is your right really to ask me, wherever you don't understand, to get knowledge up to this level, right? To develop total reliability and total confidence that whenever I design, then there is no anxiety. Put it in industry. It is going to work. It is going to work. Right? Okay. I am going to show you now, let us start the presentation. Typically, a stirred tank reactor looks like this. It is a vertical cylindrical vessel named as one. Then there are dished enclosures on both the sides. The shape can be either elliptical or hemispherical. Then there is a motor, gearbox. Motors are available at 1440 or 2880. Typical speeds are right from 20 up to 300. So we need to reduce the speed. Then here is a seal. This chemical technology students, do you have the course of engineering drawing? Yes. Have you drawn gland and stuffing box? Yes. If not drawn, you draw it in your next class. Ask your teacher. So in order to make vessel leak proof, either gland and stuffing box or mechanical seal is employed. The shaft can rotate smoothly and an impeller is connected at the top. There are baffles and liquid is filled up to certain level. So generally, these are the components. Some additional attachments like jacket outside or a coil connected outside or a coil inside or a sparger for the introduction of gas or for the introduction of immiscible liquid or a draft tube. All these possible additions I'll be teaching you, but generally these are the components. A vertical cylindrical vessel with dished ends. There is a provision for the introduction of shaft and either one or two or three impellers are provided on the shaft, and the energy required for the rotating shaft is provided by the motor. So, general arrangement is like this, right? Looks very simple, looks very simple. So, the same has been shown. So, in the first case, there is a one impeller, and here there are three impellers. I give you an example of mixing of sugar in milk, right? And that example I give in every class I teach. I told you I am teaching for 46 years. So, in all those 46 classes, I must have given this example. Right? Glass of milk, put sugar, it settles at the bottom. Right? On molecular level, molecules are never stationary, they move randomly. So, here in this case, the sugar molecules in the liquid that is milk, they move randomly. The milk molecules, they also move randomly, correct. However, if there are regions of higher concentration and regions of lower concentration, there is a concentration gradient. So, randomly moving sugar molecules from higher concentration to lower concentration and lower concentration to higher concentration, obviously there will be net transfer of sugar molecules from higher concentration to lower concentration. This molecular diffusion based flux is defined by which law? Very good, I am very happy. Very happy. So, the Fick's law is the flux is equal to minus diffusivity times dc by dx. I am explaining you, in the first picture there is one impeller, in the another picture there is three impellers, and therefore, I am explaining this particular part. So, if you take a differential volume which is dx, and at a distance of x from the bottom, and you write mass balance, those who are at the back, are you able to read? See what is there on the board? Yeah. So, if you write mass balance, of course, with respect to sugar, and this mass balance is for the differential volume. This differential. So, sugar enters the differential volume by Fick's law. It leaves the differential volume by Fick's law, and slowly the concentration will become uniform, right? So, at the beginning, if we draw, I'll draw here, the sugar concentration at the bottom is highest at time t is equal to 0. But as time proceeds, then eventually we are going to get uniform concentration everywhere. But with respect to time, now you get, initially you get like this, very little change. And finally, you will get this line. So, the time is proceeding in this direction. In terms of the governing equation, the mass balance is in minus out, whatever enters and whatever leaves, the remaining quantity is accumulated. So, this is equal to rate of accumulation. Have you derived continuity equation in the class? Equation of continuity, equation of motion, right. So, this is mass balance. So, mass balance, really law of conservation of mass, results into equation of continuity. Law of conservation of momentum gives us equation of motion. Then there is a law of conservation of energy. So, these are the governing equations all the time. So, in minus out, if this cross section is say S, phi indicates that it is a cross section. So, minus diffusivity dc by dx, this is a flux that is kilomoles per meter square second. Into cross section S, this is what is entering at x. What is leaving at x is minus diffusivity dc by dx into S at x plus dx. Is equal to accumulation, that is the volume, the differential volume is S dx, and change of concentration with respect to time minus this is equal to 0. You divide by S dx throughout and you know the definition of derivative, and you get finally dc by dt is equal to diffusivity d2c. It will be partial differential equation d2c by dx square. And when we solve it with respect to time, then we get these various lines, and you get the time required for complete homogeneity. For suppose we want to wait for 100% homogeneity, correct? What kind of time will be required? We want 100, infinity, correct? No, that is right. So, therefore, mixing time is always defined for certain degree of homogeneity. If it is 99%, is acceptable. For milk homogenization with sugar, whether it is 99% or 100% or 98% or 95%, are we able to recognize by drinking that it is 95%? So, certain level is acceptable in industrial practice, and all those expectations can be different from say polymerization to esterification to sulfonation to. And what is the origin of these different requirements, that I'll tell you in due course of time. But the mixing time is always, so if we are drawing these lines and write the time required say for 99% homogenization, then time required theta mix is equal to 0.5 times length square upon diffusivity. Let us take typical height of the glass as 100 millimeters. Why I have come to this subject is, in this picture one impeller is shown, in that picture three impellers are shown. Maybe in one case one will be rotating at 100 rpm, in another case 300 rpm. Who decides? Who takes this decision? What should be impeller design? How it should look like? I have kept here large number of designs here. Which impeller, which design we should select? What should be the diameter? Where it should be located? How many impellers we should use? What should be the inter-impeller clearance? Right? So, who is going to answer the question, all these questions? We are going to answer. So, what is the basis for that? That I am trying to explain. So, the mixing time is 0.5 L square upon diffusivity. Diffusivity of sugar in milk is 1 into 10 raised to minus 9 meter square per second. I am sure your mobiles have possibility of calculations, and for this 99% homogenization, if length is 0.1 meter square, calculate the time required. Tell me, 5 into 10 raised to 6? Seconds, and convert it into days.
Fifty-eight days,
right. So, as a common man, even as a child, also this is not acceptable, right? So, in industry what happens? If you provide anything, then the performance will be also anything. If you want good performance, then we should provide something which is good. And prior to that, we should understand what is the meaning of good. What do we do normally? We put spoon inside and rotate at certain speed. Whenever we rotate a speed, maybe next time I'm going to show a video, an impeller, I'm calling spoon as an impeller now. When impeller rotates, behind the spoon blade, vortices are generated. And these vortices detach from the spoon, and these are free to move in the milk. And these vortices contain millions of molecules, right? How many fans are here? Some number, 16, 15, some number is there. 30? 18. What is that these fans are doing? These are axial flow impellers. They are the air is leaving the impeller. What is the job fan is doing? Suppose this is a stirred tank reactor and we have provided 18 impellers. Our KV auditorium is a stirred tank reactor with 18 impellers. Who decides 18? Would 12 do the job? Will 6 do the job? Then first of all, what is the job? What is the job of a fan? Circulation. But what is the circulation does? Homogenize is definitely a good idea that it does. But the comfort that we get, what is the unit operation behind it? Very good. So, cooling is simultaneous heat and mass transfer. Is a simultaneous heat and mass transfer. So, we really need good heat transfer coefficient on the surface of the body. And for getting heat transfer coefficient, the surface velocity is important, the velocity in the vicinity of the surface. In addition to surface velocity, what is also important is level of turbulence. If the flow is turbulent, I really do not know how much I will be able to teach. But when these vortices leave the spool and let there be any design of the impeller, you rotate in stirred tank reactor, it makes vortices, and vortices are released throughout the tank while the impeller is rotating, while these fans are rotating. And these vortices are not stationary, they break. If the spool size is 20 mm, vortex may be 20 mm, and when it releases, all such vortices, I have already promised that I am going to show you video next time, then they break inside, they break. And now these vortices, they move randomly and try to do the job, something similar to molecular motion. And the same equation holds. Now only difference is, in place of molecular motion, which is random, now there is a random motion of eddies, and eddies contain millions of molecules. Therefore, the diffusivity which I have written is called molecular diffusivity. In place of that, if we write eddy diffusivity, which is orders of magnitude larger, maybe it is 10 raised to 9 times larger than the molecular diffusivity. And if that is the case, then what will be the, suppose it is, the eddy diffusivity is 0.1 meter square per second, 0.1 meter square per second, what will be the order of magnitude? Length is 0.1 square, right. So, if diffusivity is of that order, if you rotate the spool and whatever diffusivity we get, say 0.001 meter square per second, then we may get 5 seconds, 10 seconds. So, whether we get 0.5 diffusivity, 0.05 or 0.005, entirely depends upon the rate at which you are rotating the spool, correct? So, should we rotate in order to have mixing time 0.05 seconds, 0.5 seconds, 1 second, 10 seconds, 20 seconds, who takes a decision? As far as milk drinking is concerned, typically we permit 5 to 10 seconds, maybe 15 seconds. That is the order of magnitude, correct? And it depends upon person to person, but the range is the same. Now, industrially, how to take such a decision? Only that much I will teach you before a break. There will be a break, and again I will come back and teach further. Who decides this?
Depends on the kinetics. If the kinetics is very fast, then the mixing time should be compared minimum to the reaction time.
Right. Now, the statement you have said in two sentences, I'll elaborate it for 15 minutes. The objective is, it is likely that everybody has already understood, but still I'll teach for 15 minutes. Who decides this time? We have started with, there is one impeller, there are three impellers. There can be a speed of 20 rpm, there can be a speed of 300 rpm. There can be spoon, we can rotate at a speed of 1 revolution per second, or 1 revolution per 10 seconds, or 1 revolution per minute, or we can do faster. So, while rotating the spoon, while rotating the impeller, we are supplying energy. If we supply more energy, we will get shorter and shorter mixing time. Okay? So, shorter mixing time does the job faster at the expense of you need to supply energy, correct? So, the point I am emphasizing right now, which I will elaborate, nothing is free. You must have experienced this. Your age is 20 approximately, average 21, average is 21, correct? But there is nothing practically, nothing is free. If you want more efficiency, if you want faster, you will have to supply energy. So, you will have to spend something. So, we need to compare how much we have spent and how much we are getting. Suppose such mixing and homogenization is an example in industrial practice, and in pharmaceutical industry, blending is very common. The medicines are homogenized with, blended with some inert material, that is pharma. But such blending is there in all the industries. Tell me, blending in food industry, what is blended with what? Arey, you will have to tell me something. Yeah, yeah, addition of salt or addition of preservatives. If we make, say, tell me some simplest product, ketchup, tomato, yeah. Juice is another example. So, we add preservatives or we add some flavoring agents if required. And for that homogenization, and suppose we take 1 meter cube stirred tank, and 1 meter cube cannot mix in 10 seconds or 1 second, it will take 1 hour. For certain energy that you provide, it takes say 1 hour. And you are able to take 24 batches per day, and that is your productivity. You enhance the energy say 5 times, and you are able to take instead of 24 batches, 48 batches. All right. Now, you supply less energy, that now you are able to take 10 batches or 5 batches. So, there is a certain productivity because of mixing time, and for every productivity you are supplying energy. So, you really calculate, in this case the expenditure is in the form of energy, but I am teaching you as an engineer, all the time we should calculate how much money we are spending. Maybe for raw material, maybe for manpower, maybe for energy, maybe for steam, maybe interest to the bank, maybe depreciation of the equipment, maybe profit. So, all this put together, these are the inputs. Output is what is the money that we get. And then at every time, there should be always, there is always a difference between an ICT student and any student other than ICT. And this major difference is this calculation of money is always going on in the minds of ICT students. They really quickly understand what is the person in front of you is giving you a new idea in order to increase the profit. What ICT student does, if the idea is good, he first of all tries to understand and confirms that the idea is good, and then he praises the person who has given the idea. If the idea is not good, then ICT student smiles at him. Remember this, don't criticize anybody in life, smile at all the people, if possible praise them. This creative atmosphere, creative ambience in the society, that is important. We are importing most of the things because our national laboratories, our best institutions, they are not innovating. They don't understand what is the need of our society. The research institutes, they did not know that we are short of bulletproof jackets or submarines. Our students have designed engines for submarines from our institute, and at a cost which is 10 times less than what is important. I can give you a large number of examples. The point is, We are not innovative only because we have not been asked to be innovative. That is the reason one. And there is no atmosphere, innovative atmosphere. And how to create innovative? You want to create innovative atmosphere in the in-house? Everybody should be smiling, then only it will happen. You try. Tell your father, you are paying my fees, you are doing so much, buying clothes for me, and you have made my life. Tell your father, tell your mother that whatever may be the recipe and perception, whatever is the preparation, at least once in a month you praise your mother, praise your sister. The atmosphere will change. We in India, we criticize so much, we criticize everybody. And mothers are criticized very extensively. For small things, if little salt is less, then also we shout at the mother. So creating this atmosphere for innovation, this is very, very important that you remember. In 15 minutes, what I was going to teach you was who decides what should be the mixing time? And one such consideration I'm going to teach you. After I finish my course, you also tell me also, sir, you are great. Now I have taught you to tell me that you are great. Still I feel nice. And then I teach with more enthusiasm to the next class. See the effect. Forget about this specific example, but an enjoyable atmosphere, a pleasing atmosphere, a smiling atmosphere, that is the ambience of creativity. Maybe I'll take a break and then I will come back and teach you one such decision which decides what should be the mixing time. Okay? I'll come back.